Dear students, we will discuss something about the Wenck model of customs union. Jaroslav Wenck has employed the technique of offer curves to analyze the general equilibrium theory of customs union. This theory is based on various assumptions. Let us have a glance about various assumptions on which this theory is based. First one is, there are three countries, A, B and C. Country A is home country. Country B is partner country in the customs union. And country C is the non-member country. It represents rest of the world. Each of these countries consumes, produces and exchanges two commodities X and Y. Commodity X is exportable commodity of country A. Commodity Y is exportable commodity of the partner country B. Commodity Y is also the exportable commodity of the non-member country C. Neither of the two commodities is inferior at any relative price or the level of income. Before the formation of customs union, the home country A was trading with non-member country C. The pre-customs union trade situation, that is prior to formation of customs union, can be explained through the respective offer curves of the two countries. Here Professor Wenck used the concept of offer curve to explain this theory. Wenck has made use of the axis offer curve to analyze trade between the union, that is customs union, and the rest of the world, that is country C. The axis offer curves can indicate various quantities of X commodity which country A is willing to exchange with the different countries of Y offered by the non-member country C. The trade situation between the union and non-member country is explained through following figure. In the above figure, OA and OB are the offer curves of Y countries A and B respectively before the formation of the customs union. If OT1 is the terms of trade line, the trade between A and B is fully balanced at the point P, and the union countries can offer no quantity of X commodity to the non-member country C. In other words, they do not wish to trade with C because their excess offer is zero. If the terms of trade line is OT2, the country A wishes to trade at P2 on its offer curve, and the country B wishes to trade at P1 on its offer curve. Now country A offers more quantity of X than country B is willing to import. Similarly, A requires more quantity of Y than country B is willing to offer. The distance P1, P2, which is depicted in the diagram, measures the excess offer of X commodity for Y by country A. By taking a distance equal to P1, P2 from origin along the line OT2, the point R can be specified, that is OR is equals to P1, P2. Suppose now the terms of trade line is OT3. Country A wishes to trade at P4 and country B wishes to trade at P3. Country A offers more quantity of X than what country B can absorb. Similarly, country A demands more quantity of Y that country B can offer. The distance P3, P4 in this case measures the excess offer of X by country A that can be exported to the non-member country C. Now taking a distance OS equal to P3, P4, which is depicted in this above diagram, along OT3 from the point of origin, another point S can be obtained, that is OS is equals to P3, P4. By joining points R and S with the origin, it is possible to derive union excess offer curve OE. Given the excess offer curve of the union and the offer curve of non-member country, that is country C, the optimum welfare position from the viewpoint of customs union can be determined. In the below mentioned diagram, OE is the excess offer curve of the customs union and OC is the offer curve of country C, that is rest of the world. The trade equilibrium position is originally P. When the customs union is formed between A and B and common external tariff is raised against non-member country C, the excess offer curve of the union shifts to the OE1 and the trade equilibrium occurs at P1. The terms of trade line, which was originally OT1, now becomes more steep as OT2. It signifies an improvement in the terms of trade for the member countries. In both country A and country B, you can see improvement in welfare. If the union goes on rising the common tariff against the rest of the world, the excess offer curve of the customs union shifts further to the left to OE2, which is depicted in the above diagram. In this case, the intersection between OE2 and OC determines trade equilibrium position to P2. The terms of trade line OT3 becomes still steeper, indicating further improvement in the terms of trade for the customs union and worsening of the terms of trade for the rest of the world. It indicates that if customs union is formed, it is always favorable for member countries. You can see improvement in terms of trade. The increase in external tariff not only improves the terms of trade but also raises the level of welfare. The point of welfare maximization is reached where the trade indifference curve of the union becomes tangent to the offer curve of the rest of the world, that is country C. If this tangency occurs at the point P2, it indicates the optimum tariff that corresponds with the maximum welfare for the member countries of the customs union. Thus, Venn's model establishes a relationship between the level of external tariff and the welfare maximization of the member countries. This approach makes a significant departure from Wiener and Lipset's approaches. It analyzes the welfare effect of customs union without making reference to trade creation and trade diversion effects. Thank you for listening.